Good morning, church. Welcome to worship. And I should give you a chance to say good morning back. It's so wonderful to see you here. And those of you who are joining online, welcome. We know that you have a lot of choices about how you can spend your Sunday morning. Am I not on? Okay, there we go. Thank you. We know that there are a lot of different options for you to spend your Sunday morning. And so I'm grateful that you're here. It is my last Sunday to be with you here on the Houghton campus, as I will be retiring as of January 1st. And Pastor Brooke is down in Vail worshiping with them. And so we always in Vail, we like to keep in mind, we like to name that we are all worshiping together. Here in Vail, online, and so welcome. I have a couple of announcements. Thank you to our ministry team who is here to help us today in our time of worship. And we hope that you will let us know that you're here because you are part of our worship team as well. There's an insert on the inside of your bulletin. And if you're worshiping online, please check in at the link that will connect you and help us to know how we can be in ministry with you. Also, Sunday, wonderful Sunday of the choir is going to be presenting the cantata, the Christmas cantata, and then there's a lunch potluck after the service and an Advent festival for you to come together and fellowship and enjoy each other's company and be enlivened by these Advent activities. Today's the cookie walk, so don't forget to stop by and purchase your cookies. And also, we still have a few angels, or a few students who need angels. So be sure and check in with Sandy or Fred after the service with that. And with that, I think Ken Winkleman has an announcement or presentation.
I'd like to invite the members of the staff to come forward, please. Somebody needs to go find Teresa. She's vanished. As it's been our custom at Desert Skies, we've given gifts from the congregation to members of our staff at Christmas. presented Tammy with hers this morning. She left to go worship with her family. Oh, here comes Teresa. She was up tending to the cake, I think.
There she is.
Some of these people may be familiar to you. You see them during worship, some behind the scenes. Ryan, you know, he's the guy that stands up there waving his arms, you know, distracting the choir. Thank you. Mystica is our nursery attendant. Oftentimes she's down in the nursery doing her jobs. We don't see her here. Mary Jo's fumbling with the checks. Teresa's our custodian. She's the person that keeps this place clean for us. Thank you. And puts out the Christ Cafe stuff during the between the services. Raymond's our accompanist and bell choir director. And Reverend Susan is our associate pastor. And who did I miss? Stephen, I forgot. Out of sight, out of mind. Steve's at work, so we're not making him come up here. He tends to our sound booth so that hopefully you can hear us up here. Thank you, Steve.
And we do have a
check. Yeah, and at this service, you get to keep the checks. First service, we took them back. Thank you guys for all you do.
Thank you for your generosity, and now we share our traditional greeting. Heartiest greetings of joy in Jesus Christ.
Heartiest greetings of joy in Jesus Christ.
Holy One, Prince of Peace, we long for your peace and trust in your promise. We hear your call to turn toward you, to change our lives and welcome you in. Meet us here and fill our minds with your wisdom and our hearts with your peace, that our time of worship together may open us to the challenge of your dream of wholeness for all. In the name of the one who is coming, we pray. Amen.
Would you join me in the call to worship? Come, listen, a voice cries out in the wilderness. Prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God.
We come and we wait in the just peace of the coming Messiah.
Pay attention. God is removing barriers and leveling the playing field, making a way for all people to witness the glory of the Lord.
We pay attention and we wait in the just peace of the coming Messiah.
We wait and we work as God's landscapers, filling in valleys and making rough places a plain, bringing justice where conflicts and obstacles once reigned.
We wait and we work in the just peace of the coming Messiah.
As we gather, may we prepare our voices to proclaim and our hands to get messy as our lives declare the coming of our Savior and Comforter.
We come to worship and to grow in the just peace of Jesus Christ, the coming Messiah. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to invite the children to come down and spend a little time here in front of the Advent candle. And anyone else who would like to join us? I said in front of. We'll be beside. Is that okay? Robert, you want to come up a step or two? Welcome, friends. It's so good to see you. Yeah. Do you ever light candles at your house? Yeah, sometimes. Candles, we have to be really careful with real candles, don't we? Because they're fire. Yeah. So just before Christmas, the 4 weeks before Christmas, every Sunday we light another candle. And today's candle is the candle of peace. Yeah. Can you tell me what peace is? What do you think peace is? Love? Yeah. Takes love to have peace, doesn't it? Yeah. How about when you're at home and you're sound asleep in your bed? Are you peaceful then? No? Well, some of us feel like that's kind of peaceful, that our bodies are relaxed and we're not worried about anything. How about when you're fighting with a brother or sister or a friend and you're arguing? Is that being peaceful? Yeah? No? Yeah, I don't know. If I get in an argument, I feel all tense and I think it's not peaceful at all. So, but you know what? You can try that out next time you get a little bit upset with your little, is it a little brother? Yeah? Yeah. Say like, how can I, am I being peaceful? And maybe take a deep breath. I brought today some extra candles that are safe for you. They're probably not safe for your little brother, but I want you to take one. And take one. And if you look on the bottom of it, let's see if that one's ready. You should be able to turn it on. There are those who say, I may have to pull the little plastic piece off, that because of the fighting in Palestine, that the traditional lighting of all the candles at the Church of Bethlehem won't happen this year. And I don't know if you ever watched that on television or if you've ever been, but it's a most holy time. And many of us are really sad that that's not going to happen. And there are some who said, in solidarity, that none of us should light candles of peace. But your clergy team here, Reverend Brooke and I, decided that we should just light more candles and more candles and more candles to make up for those that aren't going to be lit in Bethlehem this year. Because we're all lights all over the world, right? We're all people who can be peaceful. Okay, so I put some extras on the altar, and if you want to, before you go, you can, while we're singing, you can help put some more up there as well. And every day, pray for peace for someone, okay? Who can you pray for peace for? Mom or dad? Yeah? For your dad? Yeah. For people, for children all over the world where it's not peaceful, where there's war. Yeah. And then you can think about, can I be peaceful? Okay? So let's say a prayer for peace. Ready? Put your hands together. Jesus, thank you that you show us the way to be peaceful. Bring your peace to all the children around the world. Amen. All right. Thanks for coming. Did you get your candle to come on? There you go. If you didn't, Miss Mystica can help you. Okay. Here's an extra one for Miss Lorna. Thanks for coming. Thank you.
weaver of hope and peace, help us to meet you as you come to us. Help us to prepare your way in our lives and to announce your coming in love to others. Take, O God, what we give and transform it to your glory. Take, O God, what we do and transform it to your acting. Take, O God, what we say and transform it to your singing. Take, O God, what we live and transform it to your creating. Lord, hear too our prayers for those rough places in our lives and in the lives of others that we name before you. Fill the valleys with your light, level the uneven paths with your grace, and by your Spirit, move us and others in such a way that your saving presence might be visible to all. Lord, on this Sunday of preparation, the Sunday which celebrates your peace, help there to be peace in our lives and peace in our churches and peace in our world. Where we have wronged others, lead us to humbly work for forgiveness and reconciliation. And where others have wronged us, help us to trust in your grace to mend. May we see your light and be made new in Christ. We ask all these things in the name of the one John pointed to, Christ Jesus, your living word, and the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The Old Testament reading comes from Psalms 85, verses 1 and 2 and 8 through 13. Lord, you were favorable to our land. You restored the fortunes of Jacob. You forgave the iniquity of your people. You pardoned all their sin. Selah. Incline your ear to my cry. Let me hear what God the Lord will speak. For he will speak peace to his people, to his faithful, to those who turn to him in their hearts. Surely his salvation is at hand for those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Steadfast love and faithfulness will meet. Righteousness and peace will kiss each other. Faithfulness will spring up from the ground, and righteousness will look down from the sky. The Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness will go before him and will make a path for his steps.
One voice speaks for the voice.
The gospel reading is from Mark chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight.' So John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And the whole Judean region and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, 'The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the strap of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit.'" A word of God that is still speaking.
The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord. Make his path straight." Ugh, that doesn't sound peaceful to me. In fact, I've been looking for a lot of peace and quiet lately. Going into the stores especially, I've decided I really need to be an online shopper. I'm sorry, I just can't get into the new Christmas songs. And I was so grateful yesterday for the blessing and the gift of Arizona Repertory Singers, who gave their 40th anniversary winter concert here. Felt a little more peaceful after that. So there are a lot of ways to think of peace, and so I'm wondering what comes to your mind, and it's not a rhetorical question. If you want to shout out a word or a phrase that you think of when you think of peace, I invite you to do that. Rest. Rest. How about, the noisy kids are gone. I love kids. I'm just, peace. Yeah. How about, the project is finished and it went okay. That sense of satisfaction. Any others you can think of? Being united, being like, being in nature. Yeah, something about that that brings us, that grounds us and brings us peace. Well, you know, go ahead. Calm. Calm. It's interesting how our interstate, not the highway, but how we are inside, really affects how people around us, right? We can be bringers of peace just by practicing peace within ourselves. So one of the more interesting definitions of peace that I came across this week was, peace is perfect harmony of thought and effortless being. When I hear that, I think of us all holding hands and almost levitating and singing Kumbaya or something. It's a very inward-focused kind of understanding of peace. And as we've said, important. Because unless we're peaceful, we can't spread peace. We can't influence peace in the world. Now, we know that we can't say peace or talk about peace without talking about one of its most obvious opposites, and that would be war. That would be war. And we know that there are many places in our world where we're especially mindful of the war between Israel and Gaza, or and Hamas in Gaza and Palestine, and the suffering of the people there. Also in Ukraine, places like Sudan, lots of countries in Africa and also Asia are in the middle of unrest or war. And we pray for peace for them. We pray, trusting God's promises to break into our world in big ways and small ways through the hearts of people to bring peace. We pray for ultimate peace in those places, this cessation of war. Now, I don't know if you noticed Psalm 85. It was written about the same time as Isaiah the prophet, who prophesied, we believe, about Jesus coming and bringing justice and peace and righteousness. And I love the imagery that the psalmist uses when he personifies faithfulness and righteousness and peace. Righteousness and peace will come together and kiss. Now, in Scripture, we hear a lot about righteousness. And what we have to understand is righteousness is the precursor to something we call justice. An Advent peace, the coming of Christ, is not only that peace, my peace, I leave you, inward assurance, but it is something that we call just peace. And just peace focuses on peace for everyone. Just peace is a social condition of harmony and wholeness and completeness and prosperity for everyone. And it seems impossible. And as Christians, most of us, I believe, we're probably pretty comfortable with our situation, our circumstances, in terms of, well, we have probably enough to buy our food, to keep a roof over our heads, to have transportation, to have access to the things, to health care and education. But Christians often become complacent because we forget the kind of world that Jesus was born into is pretty much like the world we experience today, especially in places like Palestine. The Roman Empire was so oppressive. The Israelites, the Jews, could not even breathe. Every penny almost that they made had to go back to the Roman Empire. If they even wanted to trade in the market, they had to vow allegiance to Caesar as God. It was tough. And Jesus came to bring peace, the just peace that gives everyone the opportunity to thrive. And so what does that mean for us? I was going to say, I like Laura Smith Haviland was a 19th century leader of an abolitionist movement in Michigan. And she was challenged by an anti-abolitionist jailer in Kentucky. And he asked her, where do you get your principles? And Haviland replied, in no uncertain term, we find them between the lids of the Bible. Righteousness and justice go together. And in the scriptures, when we hear of righteousness, we have to hear that we are called to pay attention, to use the power that we have. It's our finances, it's our position, it's our just our influence, whatever it is, to notice where some who we've assumed are where they are because, well, they get what they deserve, who cannot thrive. There are ways to work for just peace. And sometimes it's just a matter of being aware. John the Baptist calls us to a baptism of repentance. And our baptism calls us, every one of us, to do what we can to resist evil of every kind. But we can't really resist it if we're not aware that we're a part of it. And I'm not here to scold you or tell you what more you should do. I'm just reminding you that God's vision, most vividly shared with us through the life, the teachings, the sacrifice, and yes, the resurrection of Christ, is a gift for us, intended for all of us, because we won't know true peace ever, ever, until everyone knows peace and is given the opportunity to be the person God has called them to be. So what can we do? There are times when maybe there are marches. And if you're a person who wants to march on behalf of someone else, to raise awareness around injustice, we encourage you and we support you to do that. But I want you to know all of the ways, or as many as I can think of, that as Desert Skies, you are already acting for just peace. We're going to hear in a few minutes about our scholarship students from Africa University. When we support those students, it is an act of just peace because it gives them a way to get an education and to thrive and to help others to thrive. When we give to our alternative giving, it is an act of just peace. It's using our money to support and give others an opportunity. When we work for Primavera, it is an act of just peace. Our United Methodist Church, it's one of our foundational values, social justice. And your giving allows us to give our apportionments, and those go to support all of the many ministries around the world through the United Methodist Church, a church who believes that everyone has value and worth as God's children. You can go online and look up United Methodist Church Advanced Directives, and there are hundreds and hundreds of different projects that are being served around the world, and you can be a part of that. You can give to that. But lest we get too comfortable, I challenge us all to be especially aware during this Advent season. But, you know, John the Baptist said, make the way straight. Clear out the barriers. Move aside those things that would impede our journey together as a people of God. So maybe just being aware of the people who serve us, the people in the hospitals who push the wheelchair down the hall, the people who serve us our meals, the people who come and help us with our yards, because we can't really do it for ourselves. How do we regard folks who serve us because we have the privilege of being able to have access to those services? Are we willing to perhaps, in the middle of all of the politics that are going on in the division, to listen carefully and commit to looking where the person who we disagree with is actually showing a concern for people, not just policies, but people, and see where maybe there's an agreement that something needs to change. Systems need to change. And can we perhaps get on board, find a way to compromise? There are many, many ways that we can practice just peace. But I also believe that there are many, many, many ways that justice can be brought. Justice in healthcare, justice in education, justice in job opportunity, justice, justice, and righteousness go hand in hand. Both of these scriptures talk about that path. And I am feeling today a great sense of gratitude for the path that we've been on together for the last 3.5 years that I've been here. And one of the paths, of course, that, or one of the aspects of that path that I've been most focused on is planting and building that presence of grace and belonging in the area of Vail. In Vail, Desert Skies United Methodist Church is the only mainline tradition that is fully open and welcoming to all people and welcomes all people into the leadership of the church. That, my friends, is just peace. And so I thank you for the ways that you've supported that ministry. I'm grateful for the opportunity to be here, to have worked with you, and to have worked towards building and growing that community, our community of United Methodism in Vail. And it will continue. You will continue to have opportunities to support that concept of just peace in Vail and all throughout Tucson. Sometimes creating or allowing for or making a way for, as John the Baptist says, for just peace means instead of just adding another chair to the table, oh, you don't have a voice? You want a voice? Okay, come be a part of the table. Oh, no, it's much more radical than that. And I can see some of you going, okay, I'll give my chair up. Yeah, but it means, honestly, in politics, in our community civics, in our churches, that we actually step back and give a new voice that has not been heard a place at the table to speak up. So who in our community doesn't have a chance to speak up? Sometimes it's students. Young people have really great ideas, and we kind of don't want to let them speak. We want to measure their voice, make sure it's in line with what we already think. Sometimes it's the elderly or those who have different learning abilities. John the Baptist wasn't speaking in a peaceful voice. John the Baptist was excited because he saw God breaking in. He knew the Messiah was coming. And we know that Messiah as the one who is the fullest representation of God's love for us. So as I leave you today, I want you to know that God loves you. And I want you to not be afraid of what you're hearing and feeling, the tug on your heart, whatever it might be. As God is not speaking to you in order to get you in line so you're good enough for God. God knows your potential. God knows Desert Sky's potential all together as the body of Christ. And God wants you to experience the greatest love that ever was by giving up a little something of what you've always known, what you've always held tight, and finding the joy of just peace in this world. May it be so. Amen.
God provides all we need to be bearers of hope and instruments of peace in our world. We offer our gifts to be used in building bridges toward a world of just peace as a church with our community and in collaboration with spokespersons for those without voice and advocates of justice around the world. Let us gather our gifts together and present them as an offering to God. We'll now have an update from our African University students.
Scholarship to attend Africa University in Zimbabwe has been a blessing. This year was difficult for my family and for me. I have been away from Africa University for the entire year. I was disqualified from attending because of poor grades. Fortunately, I was able to work for a company in my home country of Mozambique that needed someone who could speak English, a skill I learned at Africa University. My family has suffered as well because my father lost his job. I am now eligible to return to Africa University, so I'm looking forward to going back to school in January and completing my degree in business administration. I hope that I will graduate in June. I have had many health problems during the last few years. At the present time, I have the medications I need, and I am doing very well. Thank you again for your kindness and generosity. My family and I pray that you will all have a joyful Christmas as you celebrate the birth of Christ. Your friend always, Hector Tiago.
Hello, my name is Joseph Alien. I am a South Sudanese. So I would like to send my gratitude to Desert Skies for their support. Through the support of Desert Skies, I was able to join Africa University, pursuing bachelor's degree in accounting. I'm a first year student. So I'm so happy for your support, and may God continue blessing you as you bless others. My thanks goes to Mr. Fred Killion for the support he's been doing through the time, since the time I came here. May God continue blessing you, and I'm so thankful and grateful. Thank you.
Good morning, friends. My name is Eureka JJ. For the past 4 years, the Desert Skies United Methodist Church has provided a scholarship for me to attend Africa University in Zimbabwe. Attending AU has been a wonderful experience for me. I had the opportunity to become friends with students from many African nations while I was working on my degree in agriculture. This past June, I was among almost 1,000 students who graduated from the university. It was an exciting and happy moment for me and my family. I thank all of you for making this possible. Since graduation, I have returned to my home country, Mozambique, and have been working as an intern at CureChem, a non-governmental organization that works with agrochemicals. This is new learning experience for me. I also work on a farm that is close to home where I do field work with the owners. They help me with cabbage, onion, and garlic seedlings for my own garden. I am searching for job opportunities daily. I have applied to multiple organizations and am waiting for their responses. I am also in the process of applying for a unique master's degree program at Garungasa National Park. That will start next year. I passed the first phase of the application process and completed a written test last week for the second phase. I am waiting for the results, hoping for the best. Once again, I would like to thank you for everything you have done for me. I would love to be there to thank you in person. My family and I wish everyone a meaningful Christmas and a happy new year. May the Lord bless you always. Best regards, Eureka JJ.
Our ushers will now come forward to receive our tithes and offerings. For those of you online, you can click on the donate button at the top of your screen or visit the Desert Skies website.
Oh.
Creator and weaver of peace, as we bring our tithes and offerings to you, we pray that our giving continues to point to the Christ who comes in love and compassion. May our giving in this season reflect our hope for the promised kingdom to reign in our world. We pray this in the name of the Messiah, Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Go Holden. Your wife is up here. She'd like to see you.
Last night we had a neighborhood Christmas stroll, and I dressed up like Mrs. Claus, and I kept asking the children, "Do you know where my husband is?" So here he is.
in the flesh. I've been asked to say a few words. This is, as Susan said, this is her last Sunday leading us in worship. She'll be retiring. She and Joe will be moving east so they can spoil their grandbaby. I thought back on the time that I met Joe and Susan, standing in a parking lot, socially distancing, wearing masks, preparing to deliver balloons to our graduates who couldn't participate in graduation because of COVID. And I thought, what a way to start a new city, a new ministry, in the middle of a pandemic that none of us knew how to deal with. Susan, you've done a great job. Thank you. Joe, we're going to miss you as well with your help with the flea market and the trustees. It's been a pleasure to work with both of you. And we wish you well. I get to give your wife another hug. Turn around, would you? Thank you, Joe.
And Susan, our prayer shawl ministry wants you to have a prayer shawl with much love and many, many prayers. We're going to miss you, and I personally am going to miss my fellow Grits, girl raised in the South.
Every time we eat Grits, we'll have to think of one another.
Absolutely.
You know, there's an old... It's truly been a blessing and an adventure. Yeah. We made it through COVID. You know, if you aren't sure that God has called you here to be the body of Christ, think back on COVID at its worst. It's still here. The fact that you carried on and were in ministry all the way through that, even continuing to plant a new congregation in Vail. You are awesome. God is with you. And there's an old Christian hymn. It's called Blessed Be the Tie That Binds Our Hearts in Christian Love. And our hearts will always be bound together in Christian love. God bless you, and may you be well. Let's do the benediction. How about it?
How about that for a plan?
These benedictions are much older than I am. Many of them are found in Scripture. And so I want you to know that the unbounding grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the passionate love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you now and always. Do not be afraid. Go in courage and in peace. Amen. And now let's sing our benediction as a community.